Amen. I like that.
Okay. I mean, all the way up.
Amen. Amen. From the passages that we read earlier, we want to use this talk today. Continuing in this Walking with God series.
Amen.
And looking at what does it actually mean to walk with God? You know, we hear people say it. Very often we hear people say, well, you just ought to walk with the Lord, or I'm walking with the Lord. What does that look like? What is necessary for it to happen? How do we make sure we're just not walking alone?
Amen.
Or just out on a walk by ourselves? So we want to look at this from the 9th chapter of Acts as we pull up on Paul. In his life, and how his life was just interrupted because he was walking in the wrong direction.
Amen.
And then he began walking with God. So we want to see what that looks like today. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the privilege of being able to walk with you.
Yes, God.
You desire that we walk with you. You desire that we are in step with you on this journey.
Yes, God.
This journey called life. So God, we ask that you would help bring clarification and understanding to us today.
Yes, Lord.
What this looks like. Help us to pull the page out of Paul's life and to get some understanding from his experience with you to help for our own experiences with you. So God, we thank you for your word. We ask that you would speak to us through it, that you just have a conversation with us, that you would challenge us today to grow and help us to see what it is that you desire.
Yes, Lord.
For us to see so that we can be who it is that you desire for us to be. I ask that you would forgive me of my sins and my transgressions and iniquities, and just allow me to be an instrument that you have at your disposal to have a conversation with us. Speak to our hearts.
Yes, God.
Our mind.
Yes, God.
This we ask in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Walking with God. Walking with God. Walking. Walking with God. You know what? Very often we make the mistake of trying to figure out life on our own.
Amen. Come on.
It's a mistake that all of us probably make.
Yeah.
Trying to figure out this thing called life all by ourselves. Trying to gain some sort of understanding or some sort of clarity about what we should do, where we should go,
yeah,
who we should be with. And so often we try and do this thing as complicated as it is.
Yeah.
We try and do this thing all by ourselves. For some reason or another, we tend to think that if we just find out what so-called successful people are doing.
Okay.
And look, if I just do what they do,
all right. I'm supposed to. Right.
Then I can get what they got.
All right.
Excuse me.
There it is.
I can get what they have.
Pretty much.
So often we relegate ourselves to.
Yeah.
Right. To if I just check out what they're doing.
Right.
Then the natural course of action is if I do what they do,
right,
I'm going to get with God.
Then I should have the same results that they have. I mean, we do it with all aspects of life. We do it with relationships. We see someone's relationship, and their relationship on, you know, seems to be going well, and things seem to be fine with them. And we say from afar or even up close, we may say, well, if we just do what they do,
come on, Pastor.
Yeah.
we can be where they are because we're doing what they do.
I did it three times.
That you need to stop. Or if we see someone successful in business, a successful business person, and we see that they, you know, that they've had a modicum of success financially and in the realm of their industry or whatever business that they, and we say to ourselves, well, look, if I just do what she did, if I just do what he did, then I will reap the same results that they've reaped. And what's dangerous about us thinking this way is that when we just copy what other people do, we do not take in consideration the nuances and the distinctions of their situation, and run the risk of just thinking that, well, if I do what they do, then all of a sudden everything will work out fine for me. This isn't always true, because all of our lives, all of us are on different journeys, and there are nuances to our distinctive lives that are considered in the equation of what God is doing with us. Because very often, if I just practice what I see other people doing, I run the risk of easing God out of the aspect of my life and think that, well, I just got to do this. Because it's working for them, then it's going to work for me. But what we got to understand is that God desires to be on a very personal and intimate journey with each of us. Your journey's not like my journey. I had to go through some stuff that maybe you don't have to go through. I had to encounter some things that maybe not necessarily someone else had to encounter, but in order for me to be in my on my journey with God and to walk with God, there was some stuff I had to go through. And that's why we can't discount anyone's life, because maybe it's just that they got to go through that in order for them to walk with God. Maybe they have to experience this challenge that you haven't had to deal with in order for their walk with God to have some meaning. Because you see, God, what I'm discovering and finding is that God wants us to walk with him.
Yes, he does.
Not just know about it. But he wants us to walk with him and to take our life steps with him. He wants us he doesn't want us journeying off on our own. See, one of the things that Pam and I love to do. No, we don't really love it. We like it, and it's necessary. Is to go walking. And we do it for a variety of reasons. One is to try and get in better health. But also, what walking together affords us the opportunity is to have conversation with each other. When you decide that you and your significant other, you and your spouse, you and your partner, you're gonna go out on a walk together.
Yeah.
And when you turn off the devices, it's just you and them. That's it. And what happens is what can happen in those kinds of walks and those experiences is that you have mutual conversation with one another.
Yeah.
You talk to one another. You in order to get through the walk, you talk.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, I like that. Come on now. Yeah. It's working.
Yeah,
walk it out.
Right. You do that so that you're not focused on the walk.
Yeah.
But you're focused on talking.
All right.
And having a conversation with one another. And get this. When you're on that walk, you have to go in the same
direction.
Trying to walk with your significant other and they want to go that way
right.
And you want to go to the left.
It's awkward.
Yeah. But when we're walking together, there's a degree of harmony where we're heading in the same direction. Yes. We're having conversation all along the way. Yes. And we have the same goal in mind. Well, that's what happens when two individuals are walking together, and it's what God desires for us when we walk with him.
Yes.
He wants us walking in the same direction.
Amen.
He wants us having conversations along the way. He doesn't want us taking life steps on our own. But he desires that we are walking with him, that we are walking together. And what we want to see today is look at the Apostle Paul's life, because Paul was walking in the wrong direction.
Yes.
God had to interrupt his life because he didn't desire for him to walk down the road he was going.
Amen.
So God has to interrupt Paul's life. Paul has this experience on the Damascus Road. This is prior to our text today. And he loses his eyesight, and he's given instructions from God on what he needs to do. And where we are in the passage today is that we find that there's a man named Ananias who is going to help Paul in his walk.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's powerful right there. He's going to help him in his walk.
Right.
Uh-huh.
And what we'll see as we look at this, as we look at this encounter that Paul has with Ananias, is we'll see some of the requirements that are necessary for walking with God.
Okay.
See, walking with God requires something.
Yeah.
It's not something that we just say we do because we go to church.
Right.
No, it requires something, and we'll see from Paul's experience with Ananias and how the two of them interact with one another, we get an opportunity to see some of the requirements that are necessary for walking with God.
Yes.
The first one, and sometimes often difficult for us, is that walking with God requires collaboration.
Right.
You can't do this thing called life by yourself. You can't do, I don't care how smart you are, I don't care how many degrees you have, doesn't matter where you work, where you live, what you drive, how much money you have in the bank, you can't do this thing called life by yourself.
Yeah.
Let's look at it here, at this collaborative effort that takes place in verses 10 through 14. Look at what the writer shares with us. He says, now in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord called to him in a vision, Ananias? Yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I've heard many reports about this man. and all of the harm that he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem.
Yes.
And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name.
Right.
Now check this out. Check this out. Here's what the writer. The writer tells us that there's this brother in Damascus named Ananias. And Ananias hears from God in a vision and tells him, look, I need you to go to this house, to the house of Judas. He lives on Straight Street, right? And I want you to ask for this brother named Saul, who's from Tarsus. It's his hometown. I want you to know, because see, God wants it clear to him.
Right.
That Judas lives on Straight Street. There's somebody at his house named Saul,
right,
whose hometown is Tarsus. He's there praying. I want you to go connect with him and place your hands on him so that you can help restore his sight. What happened with Saul is that when Saul has this encounter with God, Saul loses his eyesight.
Yes.
Here he is at Judas's house on Straight Street, and he's praying because what Saul is doing is following the directions he's received in his experience with God. He's doing his part.
Yeah, that's right.
God, on the other hand, is working on this brother named Ananias, who knows where Judas lives,
yeah,
and knows that there's a guy named Saul who's there praying.
Yeah.
God is doing God's part in Ananias' life.
Yeah.
Saul is doing Saul's part in his own life.
Yes.
And what is going to happen with them is that when the two of them connect together,
yes, they
will collaborate and connect together for the benefit of Saul.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay. See that?
Okay. Sometimes many of us struggle because we only want to listen to us. All I hear is my voice. My voice.
I know, right?
My voice. I don't want to bounce nothing off of anybody else because y'all might tell me something I don't want to hear. God is fixing up Ananias so that Ananias can collaborate with Saul so that his life can be changed.
Yeah, thank you, Paul.
See, God didn't call us to live in isolation and separation.
Yeah, thank you, Paul.
There ain't nothing, excuse my English, ain't nothing that you dealing with that other folk ain't haven't dealt with before.
Yeah.
I don't care how crazy you think your life might be. There is nothing new under the sun.
That's right. Yeah.
But so often we get so secretive and we want to isolate ourselves and separate ourselves and not collaborate with other folk. And all the while what we're doing is shortchanging ourselves.
Yes, Lord.
We're hurting ourselves because I want to live in isolation and separation, because you know what? I don't want nobody to have any idea about my situation.
Ooh-wee.
Don't you know that your situation,
okay,
excuse my English,
ain't
the first situation?
It won't be the last.
Right. But what we have to understand is that look, when I am willing to work and collaborate and work with other folk. And now, there are some folk that don't need to be in your life. Yes, period. Okay, yes, that's true. How you can tell whether or not they need to be there is right here in the text. Ananias, look, he says, All right, he says in verse 12, he says, in a vision, he has seen a man, he's talking about Saul, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight.
Yes.
That was Saul's, that was part of his issue at the moment. The blindness.
Yeah.
See, the way you can tell whether or not people ought to be involved, certain people ought to be involved, is whether or not they are helping you to become better.
All right, Whoa. Pastor. All right.
Look. Can I say Negro?
Yes, you can say Negro. Bro. Bro.
If a Negro isn't helping you become better.
Right.
If they're not challenging you to become better and to grow and to develop and to become a better version of you, that's somebody that needs to be cut.
All
right.
If people are all they can do is take from you.
Yes.
And can't contribute to you.
Right.
Oh. Yeah.
They need to be cut.
Yeah.
Come on, man. This, look.
You're stirring us up. You're really stirring us
cut
up.
Cut off. Not.
You're stirring us up. You're going to go home and cut everybody.
Yeah, I can see that, somebody.
Right.
Go home, go to the kitchen. They need to be cut off. They need to be cut off.
Jesus.
And that means, and what that means is that that the access that they have.
Amen.
That's what it, you know, the amount of access that they have to you.
Yeah.
That needs to be, if people are just taken from you, you've got to reduce the amount of access that they have to you.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Only you can set up those boundaries.
Yes.
God is working on Ananias. Amen. So that he can get there and see that there's a brother named Saul who is in a condition of blindness that he needs to help to better his condition and better his situation. Now, Ananias has already heard about the reputation of Saul.
Oh, yeah.
Because look at what Ananias says in verse 13. He said, look, I heard many reports about this man and all the harm that he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem.
Amen.
And not only has he done harm, but he's come here with authority from chief priests to arrest anyone else who calls on your name.
Okay.
See, Saul was headed the wrong way. And here he is. Ananias is going to work with him for Saul's benefit and his development.
Amen.
See, when we learn how to get a trusted circle of confidants, whatever you want to call them, whatever you want to label them, whatever you want to name them, when you learn how to get a trusted circle of people that you can communicate with and that are going to be honest with you,
yeah,
they help you grow.
Yes, they do.
Yeah. Yes.
And that means, look, that means I had to get around people who know stuff I don't know.
That's right. Say it again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I don't know why we sometimes feel so threatened by being around people who know stuff we don't know. I had to know everything.
No way.
Look, if you in a circle and you know everything, you know everything, and you know more than everybody else in the circle.
Right.
Guess what? You're in the wrong circle.
I know.
Because you need people who know things you don't know.
That's right.
So that they can help sharpen you.
Yes.
So that I can say, well, look, I've been thinking about this, and this is what is going on in my life. What do you think?
Yeah.
Amen.
I need people in my life like that because it helps build me up. But if I put, if if I situate myself around people and I'm the smartest Negro in the room, guess what? I'm in the wrong room. They collaborate together. Ananias gets his instruction from God. Saul gets his instruction from God. Coming together, they are going to help benefit and develop Saul's life.
Yes.
Saul's going to become better because of the collaboration.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
It's just like churches. We have all these churches around here, and we had to compete with each other.
I know.
Instead of collaborate with one another.
Yes.
Collaboration is a requirement of walking with God, because God's going to put people. God's going to pull people.
Yeah.
God's going to inspire people.
Yes, yes, yes.
How to help bring direction and guidance and benefit to our lives.
Yes.
We have to be in a place where we're willing to collaborate rather than isolate ourselves.
Amen.
But not only is collaboration important, but secondly, we see here is that the second thing we see is that collaboration is critical, but also in order to walk with God, another thing it requires is designation. Not only collaboration, but designation, because look at what verse 15 and 16 says. Look at what he says to Ananias, because remember, God tells him, go to Judas' house on Straight Street. There's a guy there praying.
Right.
His name is Saul. He's from Tarsus. Don't want you to make a mistake with who we're talking about here. All right? I need you to connect with him so that his situation will change. Ananias, man, I heard about the reputation of this dude.
Right.
But look at what Ananias, look at what the Lord says to him. It says, but the Lord said, verse 15, go. This man is my chosen instrument. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel.
Hallelujah.
I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. This I find really interesting is Ananias is, I can understand his struggle, because if you look at Saul's past,
then
it's not worth it. I can understand his struggle. God, I hear you.
But
I've heard about this brother.
Right. Yeah.
It's understandable to have that tension within yourself that, you know what?
Yeah.
I don't know if is it really worth. Because this is the stuff he's done.
Right.
And he on assignment right now.
Right. Authority. Yeah, right.
So.
Gosh. You want me to go?
Looking at what I see, I don't see that it is it really worth.
Yes.
Because look, he's on a mission to arrest people now.
Right.
God has to tell Ananias, I chose him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Look, you can write people off if you want to.
All right.
Pastor. I know how we get sometimes. We look at a person's past and we say, well, you know, I don't know. You know, they've done this, they've done that, they've been here, they've been there, they've done this, they've done that. They have a rap sheet as long as I don't know what they've been. So I don't know if it's really, really, really worth, you know, I don't know if anything is going to come out of their life.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
God tells Ananias, I've chosen him.
All right. Yeah.
Look, look. And he tells him, I've chosen him to be an instrument to proclaim my name. Now get this. To the Gentiles.
I know.
It gets better though.
It's like, look, I have a unique assignment for him. Look at his past if you want to.
Right.
Look at his present if you'd like to. Yeah. But I'm looking at his future. If you don't ever remember anything else, listen. God has designated you.
All right, Pastor.
Yeah. Chosen you.
Yeah.
Out of all, what's it, about 7 billion people around here on this planet?
You were taking one.
About 7 billion people on this planet. God has chosen you.
Thank you, God.
Wow,
thank you, God.
Because can't nobody else do you,
thank you, God.
Like you.
Thank you, God.
Yeah. I don't care if people tell you you ain't tall enough, you ain't light enough, you ain't dark enough. I don't care if people say the texture of your hair is not. I don't care what people try and use to disqualify you. God has chosen you. Out of the billions of people on this planet.
Yes.
Wow. You.
That's so powerful.
Yes.
For a unique mission for him.
Yes. Mm. Thank you, God. Mm. Thank you, God.
Something that only you can do it the way you do it.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Mm. He's chosen. You've been designated.
Yeah.
With all of my faults,
yes.
My failures,
yes.
My shortcomings,
yes.
Even when I messed up last night, this morning, gonna mess up this afternoon, he still chose you.
Thank you, God.
I've been designated, you've been designated for something special that only you can do.
Thank you.
That only you can do it.
Thank you.
So you can't let people diminish.
Thank you, God.
Who you are.
Thank you, God.
Yeah.
I don't care where you were born, where you live. Doesn't matter whether you live in a mansion or on the street. God's chosen you.
Yes.
You've been designated for something special.
Yes.
You have to find out what it is,
yes,
and talk on it. Do it.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
Because you know what could have happened to you? You could have been a miscarriage.
I know, right?
Or aborted.
You could have been an abortion.
Yeah. Yeah.
When mama and daddy got together,
yeah,
it could have gone another way.
Thank you.
Yes, it could have.
But no, he's allowed you.
Thank you, God.
To come forth. You're designated for something that has to be done by you.
Yes.
Listen, he tells him, I've chosen him. Ananias has to look at Paul's past and talk about Paul's past.
Yeah.
God says, look, I've chosen him.
Yeah.
And he talks about his future.
Yeah.
To proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. In other words, Paul's mission was going to be different than the mission of the other apostles.
Come on, Pastor.
Yeah.
See, the road he was going to have to travel, the journey he was going to have to take was going, it's different than the other apostles.
Yes.
That's why he got so much flack all the time. But whether or not you were really, truly legit.
That's right. That's right.
He got so much flack from people because the road he had to travel was different than the majority.
Yeah.
So then people question his authority, his legitimacy. He must not be real because he didn't do it the way the other people did.
That's right. That's right.
Can we do the same thing with people today?
Yeah,
we delegitimize people today because their walk, their journey has been different. Last thing, because we have to go. Walking with God requires collaboration, designation, and most importantly, it requires elimination. There's some stuff that God has to eliminate in your life.
Yes.
So you can move to where he wants you to go.
Amen.
There's some stuff. There's some stuff. Some of it might be in the form of people. Maybe she was supposed to let you go.
Yeah. I figured that out.
You know what? Maybe he really needed to let you go.
Yeah.
So you can get to where you're supposed to be going.
All right. Exactly.
So let's look at it here, verses 17. Through 19 says, then Ananias went to the house and entered in. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again.
Yes.
He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength.
Thank you, Bob.
Here's something interesting that the writer is sharing with us. Ananias, yeah, he struggles with it, but understands, look, I'm on a mission. I got to go do what God says do.
Right.
Places his hands on Saul. And I'm happy that Ananias declares in the name of the Lord Jesus rather than in his name.
All right. Thank you.
Because Ananias really couldn't see what God was going to do with Saul.
That's right.
So what Ananias does is says, in the name of the Lord Jesus, whom appeared to you on the road, on your road here, on your journey here, the one who appeared to you in that experience you had here, he's the one who sent me.
Yes.
And I'm here in order so that you might be able to see again.
Yes.
And so that you can be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And in an instance, Saul's scales fell from his eyes, and he got up, got baptized, ate a little something, and regained his strength.
Yes.
Here we see something interesting. It's that there had to be something eliminated in Saul's life so that he could change, so that the transformation could take place from Saul to being Paul. Ananias, who wasn't too sure about the situation, was sure about God.
Yes.
So he tells him, in the name of the one that you had an experience with on your road here, he's the one who told me to touch you and so that you can be delivered from your blindness.
Yes.
And in the midst of that, the scales fell from Saul's eyes.
Yes.
He gets baptized and he eats. And now he's starting to get strong again.
Yeah.
Saul's life is interrupted by God so that he can start walking with God. He has to be. And for some of us, God has to interrupt stuff.
Thank you, God.
God has to cause some stuff to happen so so that it can be eliminated in our life, so that we can get on living with life. See, so many of us have stuff in our lives that's hindering us from moving forward. And we keep wondering, well, why can't I just stay comfortable with the comfortable? Because it's the comfortable that will lull you to sleep. And before you know it, comfortable becomes complacency. Complacency keeps going. And then before you know it, you're not living the life that God has designed and destined for you to live. But if you would allow God to take away some things from your life that don't belong there, if you could just understand that when God starts cutting back and pruning, when God starts eliminating stuff, it's all for my benefit and not to my detriment. See, the thing about walking with God, the thing about walking with Him is that even in the difficulties when those things happen, God is going to be there
He will.
For our development.
Yes, He will.
That's right.
Yes.
So that we
thank you, Lord.
Yes. So that we can keep going.
Yes.
So that we don't lose heart, and so that we don't faint. So that we don't just throw in the towel. So that we don't just give up.
That's right.
Listen, I'm
thank
first,
you, Lord.
I think it was Thursday night. Pam and I, we were doing our routine, our walking routines, and we're up to we're four miles. We're up to walking 4 miles.
Right. Good for you.
Usually every day, if not every day, three, four days, at least 4 days a week. Mm-hmm. So Thursday, we're out taking our walk. Right after she got off work. But what had happened was earlier that day,
I did some.
It's not. Okay. It's not bad. I did some extra work because I gotta get rid of this, right? So I did some bleachers earlier that morning, right? But I knew that once she came home, we were still gonna take our walk in the evening. So we're taking our walk, right? I'm a little tired, right?
Right.
But I'm like, you know what? Now I'm gonna go ahead and walk. I know, you know, I'm a little tired from earlier, but I'm gonna go walk with her because I just wanna be a good husband, right? and go walk. No, for real.
Right, for real.
I don't know if I can say that.
Probably not.
I should.
You got to think about it. Probably not.
Hold that one.
For real. You know how, like, sometimes the ladies work in, like, they work out and stuff that's kind of like,
Hello.
And for real, the thing is that I just don't want her walking on the street by herself with stuff like that on. So I'm dead tired. But I'm like, you wearing that? Oh no, I'm going with you. I'm walking. I'm like dead tired, but I'm walking, right? So we walking first mile. Second mile, then I started to tell her, I said, you know what, honey, I'm kind of tired. I said, I don't know if I can finish the entire walk.
Right.
And she's like, well, okay. Okay.
Okay.
So I'm like, okay, all right. I said, but you know what, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep pushing, and I'm going to keep on going. And then, so then we're like, we make it halfway, and then we're on our way back, right? And I'm like, babe, I don't know if I'm gonna make it. So then she wants to challenge my manhood, right? And she's like, well, do you want me to call Imani and have him come pick us up?
Uh-oh.
I was like, no! You know, you ain't gotta call him. No, I'm all right. So then what we do, right, is she says, well, look, listen, how about we do this? Let's switch to the other side of the street because there's shade on that side and maybe you'll feel a little bit better. So I'm like, all right, yeah, let's do that. Let's switch. So we're walking, and then we come up to a bus stop, and she's like, well, do you want to stay here? You want to sit here at the bus stop and wait for a while and kind of get yourself together before? I'm like, no, I'm going to keep on going. I'm going to keep on going. So then finally I tell her, I said, look, you know what? I'm just really not feeling good and stuff, and I'm really feeling tired. I don't want to hold you up, right? So why don't you just go ahead, and I'm just going to go at my pace, and you go ahead and go at your pace. This is what she says to me, Jim. Check this out. This is what she says to me. I didn't understand it at first. I understand it today. She says, no, I don't want to go ahead of you because I need to stay close to you. Because you might drop. I turn around and you're not there. So first I thought she was like, you know, trying to take a shot at me. I'm like, hold up. I might drop. I'll walk you. So, but get this. So, I didn't understand it then, but I understand it now. It's the same way God walks with us. Look. God wants to stay close.
Yes, He does.
Because sometimes there's stuff in our lives. Sometimes there are experiences that we are going to have that we might not have enough strength to deal with. And He wants to stick close and stay close because there might be something that you just can't handle. And I need to be close to you so that I can encourage you and push you and be assistant to you. That's what happens when we walk with God. But when we're walking on our own, but ain't no telling what might happen on our journey. But when I walk with Him, guess what? He walks by my side. He stands there with me. And when I need to take a break, He'll take a break.